I will be asking Mr. Miles some fairly personal questions, but she doesn't mind you being present.
My client understands, and she agrees I should be present for...
Maybe Dr. Glass is right, and we should be alone for this.
Catherine, I strongly advise you not to contemplate
having... Is this where we're gonna do it?
Hey everybody, welcome to Attack of the Show. You know, Basic Instinct 2, it's out tomorrow. Now, is this a thrilling sex romp worth your time or a glorified Skinamax special? Find out right here. Plus, specs! Yes, we've got specs for the Nintendo Revolution. We've got the info that's going to be the fuel for Flame Wars for 100 years, and you're going to get it right here. And our comic book expert, Blair Butler, finds time to get us the best comics and check out Jay and Silent Bob's secret stash. Now, settle down, everybody, so we can begin the attack of the show.
Pick up on this.
Attack of the Show. I'm Kevin Pereira.
I'm Sarah Lang. Good
How you
to
doing?
See y'all.
Doing good?
I'm fine, Kevin. How are you?
Good.
You look so nice today.
Very dapper.
You really clean up well when you want to.
Thank you. 40 pounds of makeup. Takes a team of people, actually. Yesterday, the specs for the Nintendo Revolution, they were released on IGN.com.
Sure.
Basically, the information reinforces what most of us already suspected. The system is not going to match the power of the PlayStation 3 or the Xbox 360. Well, it's all right. The specs provide a bunch of talk, a bunch of tech jibba-jabba about megahertz and gigabits and Hollywood and Broadway chips and internal, external RAM. Forget it. Let's cut to the chase and explain things in plain English. Basically, the Revolution falls somewhere between the GameCube and the original Xbox in terms of performance, overall horsepower. Which really isn't much of a surprise, considering Nintendo's president, Satoru Iwata, he has said all along that they are not trying to wage a technology war against Microsoft and Sony. What Nintendo is trying to do, however, is provide a system, a new system that offers a quiet and small, affordable alternative with a really sweet-ass controller. A controller that, according to Nintendo at least, could potentially change the way that games are played forever, Sarah Lane. So I guess the question to be answered is, will gamers be willing to sacrifice power and graphics for an innovative controller and all the old Nintendo games they could ever want? I certainly am, but for everybody else, we'll have to wait until the Revolution hits stores to really find out.
I think curiosity will kill the cat on this one.
I think it's going to appeal to so many gamers that are confused when they see really convoluted button layouts and two thumbsticks. It's like, no, just hold this thing in your hand and wave it around, sweetheart. I promise it'll be fun.
It's a little refreshing, too, to hear a company that's like, we're not, you know, in the war to be the fastest, greatest,
sure.
You know, screaminest.
Yeah, it's like, there's another way to approach this.
We don't want to, and it's on purpose.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Now, just when you thought it was going to go away like a pair of shriveled up testicles, the steroid saga continues to put a black cloud over Major League Baseball. According to an announcement yesterday, MLB Commissioner Bud Selig has decided to launch an investigation into the alleged steroid use by San Francisco Giants slugger Barry Bonds, as well as others. Now, we're not implying anything, but just, you know, take a peek at Mr. Bonds, like, say, 1987 and then today. Now, we're not saying that it is steroids. It just could be gamma radiation, perhaps.
Oh, Kevin.
You don't know. Things happen. Personally, I think they should just legalize steroids in baseball. I mean, it'd be exciting to see a bunch of gigantic superhumans cranking out homer after homer. Plus, the high probability that their overburdened hearts would explode while they're rounding third base, it's just that added bit of excitement and danger that the sport is really missing.
Maybe he's just really good.
Dude, your head cannot
Maybe
expand 13
really
hat sizes
Maybe he's just a really good ball player
in 10
about
years.
To break some records. Maybe...
Whatever.
I'm not saying anything.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Let's move on to America's other favorite pastime, which, of course, is the movies. Oh. This weekend is loaded with a bunch of new releases if you're interested in going. First up, Sharon Stone dusts off her ice pick and the long-awaited sequel to Basic Instinct. It's been like 14 years since the first one, so this movie has obviously been generating all sorts of hype. Some of it's been good. But most of it's been pretty bad.
Yeah.
If your idea of a good time doesn't involve watching an older woman than your mom, pretty old, simulate sex, and that's fine. Me too. There's always Slither. That's a crazy horror comedy from the writer-director of the Dawn of the Dead remake. You might know him. It's got aliens, zombies, mutant slugs, pretty much everything. Certainly Sweet. Looks unique from the trailers. And finally, the Beastie Boys have an innovative concert film called Awesome, I Effin' Shot That. It was taped entirely by their audience members using cameras that the Beastie themselves loaned them before their 2004 concert at Madison Square Garden. Cool idea. And don't panic, Chud.com's Nick Nunziata is going to be joining us after the break to let us know which ones he thinks are worth seeing and which ones are certainly not.
He's got the details.
The deets.
The deets for you
That's
kids.
What we like to say.
Now, we're here to answer all of your questions, perhaps regarding the Nintendo Revolution. It's big news. You might be worried. You might have a call, a little question. Give us a ring. The number is 800-839-7880. And you can email us through our web form at attackoftheshow.com/askus. And, of course, you can always chat with us in our IRC chat room as well. It's chat.g4tv.com.
And if we take your questions, we'll give you a copy of Kingdom Hearts 2.
Nice.
So you want your question answered today. Coming up after the break, Nick Nunziata from movie rumor site chud.com helps us plan our movie-going weekend. Stay with us.
Welcome. I am Dr. J. Hopkins of the Dorkma Initiative, and this is another Lost viewer orientation. Let us begin with last night's episode, episode 205, The Lockdown, which, let me say, was a real whopper, was really good. First incident, the map discovery. Locke was trapped inside the hatch during the aforementioned lockdown. A map was revealed, drawn on one of the blast doors. This map shows the location of all the other bunkers on the island. These bunkers have also been blocked off from a central area identified with a question mark. This is, obviously, the area sealed off with giant concrete doors that Locke and Jack had discovered previously. There are also a series of Latin quotes on the map, one of which is translated as, "The remedy is worse than the disease." The quote was written next to a bunker identified as the medical center. It is also a quote from the poet Virgil, who was Dante's guide through hell and purgatory in The Divine Comedy, which you've read. Incident 2, the discovery of the rations. There was mention of a PRD, or parachute ration drop, on the map, and a note that they happen every 6 to 8 months. The PA announcement Locke was trying to decipher was an alert that the bunker inhabitants were going to be locked in while the food was dropped and distributed. The crackling effect you heard was also a... Which definitively explains what that spooky cloud of black smoke is. Take that, Peter Jackson. That is all. Again, I am Dr. J. Hopkins, and on behalf of the Dorkma Initiative, I thank you for your participation in Lost. Good day.
For the first weekend in a long while, we've got some decisions to make regarding which movies we're actually going to shell out some cash to see. So joining us live via satellite to make our decision a little easier, it's Chud.com's Nick Nunziata. Hello there, Nick. Welcome to the show.
Hey, how's it going?
It's going very well. We're very confused here. Lots of good movies coming out, and I wanted to start with Basic Instinct 2 if we can, because we've all seen the internet teaser, which showed all kinds of nudity, and, you know, we've heard the buzz. People are excited. You know, Sharon Stone, she's making a comeback. A little crusty. But what is this movie about, though? Is it just flashes of nudity for 2 hours, or is there a plot that anybody would care to see?
Well, the plot is this. She's in England, and she has a lot of sex.
Okay,
that's pretty much the script, the script for the film.
I would green light that. No, I mean, there's got to be something more. Now, I mean, it
control. Like me.
Perhaps not?
Honestly, what you've got is the premise is that Sharon Stone kills her lover in a car accident. And she goes to therapy, and David Morrissey, the new star of the film, ends up becoming her mate. And you know, it's the Basic Instinct idea has never been built around a lot of plot. You know, it's the banging of pelvises.
Right. Well, I mean, you know, Sharon Stone, she's all over the media now. She's talking about how she wanted this movie to have more sex in it. You know, when the movie first came out, nudity, of course, was a big selling point. But you know, what am I going to get here that I couldn't find just going to Google and searching for naked old has-been?
Well. That's a good sight. Just so you know, I mean, like, I think what Sharon Stone's doing is she's trying to advance sell some of the unrated DVDs that you know are going to come out. The word on the street is that this isn't nearly as sexy as the first one because it doesn't have Michael Douglas's sagging ass. But what it does have is Sharon Stone desperately, you know, she's a good actor. She proved it. But I think, you know, she's trying to relive her her box office glory, you know, about a decade late. So I mean, I think this is the kind of film that might be fun to go see on a Friday night with the guys for like just some dumb leave your brain in the car cinema. But otherwise, it just seems like one of those things where she's trying to cash in, but the ATM machine's been closed for 7 years.
Yeah, definitely, definitely. If you want to see wrinkles, adopt a Sharpay and put that on a handy cam for a little while, right? I want to move on now to the Beastie Boys. Awesome, I effing shot that. It's another concert movie, and there's so many concert films out there. You know, what's the hook that's going to separate this one from anything else, like a Chappelle's Block Party or any of the other concert flicks?
Like Basic Instinct 2.
Yes. Basically,
obviously it's the Beastie Boys, and the big gist of this is that they gave 50 cameras to their audience, let them shoot the film, and then they set themselves up for an editing nightmare and had all these 50 cameras edited into being the concert film, which is a novel idea. I'm not going to say that if you're a fan of Norah Jones, you're going to want to see this movie. But if you like the Beastie Boys and if you like that kind of energetic vibe, then it makes perfect sense. You know, it's a really cool idea.
I mean, I've been to a Beastie Boys concert or two in my life. Is there a high probability that I'm just going to see people's feet in line for the bathroom and lots of vomiting and drunks, you know, screaming at women to take their tops off? Because I'm sold if so, but I'm curious, should we expect something better from their fans in this film?
No, although they probably could have made a few Dogma films if they kept that footage. No, what I think you got here is what they're going to try to give you the you were there sensation. They're going to show the you know, it's about the fans. I mean, a lot of bands, especially bands that have lasted two decades like those guys, they wouldn't be around if it wasn't for a very rabid fan base. And this is kind of sharing it with them. And I mean, it's a great idea. It's not going to convert anybody, but it does kind of give you an almost, you know, virtual feeling. In this day and age, it's probably what people are craving.
That's true. It's a good take on it. Finally, we mentioned Slither at the beginning of the show here. Now, the writer of Dawn of the Dead got Nathan Fillion from Serenity. I know people around here are excited about this, but should they be?
I think 100%, yeah, because first of all, James Gunn, who made the film, he grew up in the same period a lot of us did, where movies were fun, they were gory, you get some nudity, you know, it was not about the self-referential Scream stuff, and it wasn't about trying to be too gritty for your own good like some of the recent films have done. It's just fun. It's fun, and it's gory, and it's wet, and it's sticky, and it's messy, and it's got Michael Rooker, and how can you go wrong with Michael Rooker?
Does it deliver on the level of gross out and the level of kind of shock and awe that people have been hyping on the internet?
Yeah, it's not bloody, though. It's gooey. You know, it's the kind of stuff that, I mean, John Carpenter and David Cronenberg, you know, the whole body horror thing that Cronenberg made so great in The Fly, and The Thing, which is pretty much one of the best films, you know, made in any genre. It's all about that icky, sticky stuff, and it's not realistic, so it shouldn't repulse people in that way. It's just gooey. It's the kind of stuff that you don't want to get on you, you know. But it's done with a very playful nature in an Evil Dead type vibe, you know, Shaun of the Dead, Night of the Creeps, all that kind of stuff. And how can you go wrong with those kind of films? They're classics. They endure forever.
Okay, so our viewers are out there. They've got, you know, $87.50 burning a hole in their pocket. They can afford to see one movie this weekend. Which one out of the three that we talked about do you think they need to see?
Disclaimer, I'll put an asterisk. If you're a Beastie Boys fan, your decision's already been made up, but you've probably already bootlegged it anyway. But you got to see Slither. You got to see Slither because it's the kind of horror film we've endured a lot of crap in order to see. So I'm all for it.
Slither. Nick Nunziata, awesome. Thank you for the pick. I will let everybody know Slither's the place to be. Thank you for your time there, buddy.
Thank you.
Everybody, for more cinematic happenings under development, be sure to check out Chud.com. There's the address right there. Now, still ahead, the feed provides your recommended daily allowance of news, and we bring you comic books from deep within the lion's den. Yeah, that's right. Jay and Silent Bob's Secret Stash. All that right after this. And now we hit the comic shops to find this week's best offerings. It's a little something we call fresh ink. Blair Butler, ladies and gentlemen, you know her, you love her. What do you have for us this week, Blair?
Well, this week we actually thought we'd try something a little bit different. There are a lot of different comic shops all over the LA area, and we thought we'd take a closer look at one of them.
Ah, Secret Stash. Yeah, the name of this comic book store probably makes you think of weed. But what makes this place different is the fact that it's owned by Kevin Smith. Yeah, that Kevin Smith. He started the Stash as a labor of love in Red Bank, New Jersey, but this LA-based store is a comic book mecca for ink geeks from up and down the West Coast. Just don't mention the West Coast Avengers. I don't like to talk about that fairly embarrassing chapter in comics history.
We sell DC, we sell Marvel, we sell a lot of the indies. A lot of the stuff that you expect to see in a comic book store. We sell toys, apparel, statues, memorabilia.
The LA store opened its doors in September of 2004 and draws fans for its mountains of merch and for its frequent celebrity visitors. And of course, Mr. Smith drops in from time to time to check up on his baby.
I usually say just pop in from time to time, because whenever either Kevin Smith or Jason Mewes are in the area, they pop in.
Comic fans come from miles around just to get their books signed by famous comic creators like artist Jim Lee and scribe Jeff John.
Our first signing for our opening actually went just about 24 hours. We stayed until everybody got everything they wanted signed. And we're doing excellent business, and we're providing something for the community that they didn't have before.
So if you're in the LA area, be sure to roll by the Stash, because there's plenty to buy, and Kevin Smith wants your money.
All right, so that's the Secret Stash, huh?
Yes, Kevin Smith's little baby.
People should go and peruse the comics. What do you have for us this week, though, Blair?
Starting out, we have Blue Beetle number one. This is a DC comic, an old DC character, Blue Beetle, big fan favorite. And they killed him. They shot him in the face, and he's dead. So now he's replaced.
There's a new one.
Yeah, he's a young, feisty kid. And I have to say, you know, the writers really have their work cut out on this one because the fans like the old guy. They have to introduce the new guy. The one thing I really liked about it was just that the suit's sort of doing its own thing independent of the kid, and he's freaking out. We've seen a lot of comics where kids get these powers, and they're learning how to use their powers, and it's all set up. And so this one's, unfortunately, just a browse for now, just because it's a little familiar, and that's just sort of the par for the course when you're introducing a new character.
All right, let's move on. Tag and Bink, number one?
Right. This is Star Wars, The Return of Tag and Bink. This is kind of a cult series. The fans really dig this one. It's a funny look at the Star Wars universe. You have these two rebel soldiers, these bumbling guys, that are basically, this all takes place in the Return of the Jedi episode of Star Wars. And so they're in scenes from the movie, and they're bumbling through them. And I think Star Wars fans are going to dig it.
It's funny. It reminded me a little bit of Troops, which is kind of funny that it would, because it's written by Kevin Rubio.
It is, yeah, who did Troops. So, I think for hardcore Star Wars fans, this one's a buy. It's funny. The jokes are funny. But I have heard, Kevin, actually, that you and Sarah may be appearing in an upcoming episode of this comic.
I don't want to toot the old horn, but there is a cantina scene that apparently is going to feature us.
Yeah.
Mr. Rubio has penciled us in.
Which is very cool. So,
what's the verdict on this one, though?
The verdict on this one, hardcore fans, a buy. Everybody else, a browse. So,
All right. Moving on, finally, Aliases, number one. Another beginner.
This is the Alias Omnibus. This actually gathers together the entire run of Alias. It's collected together in one hardcover edition.
One giant-ass book, right?
And it costs $75. This is great. It has every issue.
Does it have any extras, though?
It's got extras. It's got all these backstories with Jessica Jones. The character was... Jessica Jones, she's a former Avenger, now she's a private eye. And so basically, I say if you have the $75, buy it, because it's great, but if you're poor like me...
Just steal it.
Yes, theft and mayhem and... Don't steal it.
Don't steal it.
Your
Save
comic
up.
Book retailers
get a,
need money.
Get a paper route or something.
Yeah, exactly.
Blair, thanks for coming
Embezzle on. Embezzle it from the government.
Comics. Of course. Thank you very much, Blair. Don't forget, everybody, to visit attackoftheshow.com for links to all of these comics. Still ahead, all the news you could possibly want. We call it the feed. And our bulletproof Final Four predictions coming up next, everyone. Attack of the Show,
attack. That isn't possible. Nothing can do that.
Captain.
Kirk here.
Captain. Strange clouds, Earth.
Cloud.
Fire into it immediately.
So violent. Have you ever wondered just how many red shirts were sent to the undiscovered country? Well, now you'll know thanks to G4's groundbreaking interactive series, Star Trek 2.0. That's right. Bringing you the original Star Trek series like you've never seen it before, Star Trek 2.0 is an interactive experience where you don't just watch Star Trek, no. You participate in it. Star Trek 2.0 debuts right here on G4 April 10th at 11 p.m. Hey, you call yourself a Trek buff, well then be there, all right? Now, coming up in this half hour, will a certain arts and craft website make us an anatomically correct porn star doll? Find out. Plus, it's Live Music Thursday, and we'll have a performance by the band The Nervous Return. But first, we know we've got a responsibility to get you the important news, and nobody learns you like a Sarah Lane.
That's right. Nobody. Now, without further ado, it's The Feed. All right, let's start off with some news that rocked the music world. The Los Angeles City Council has been ordered to pay the family of slain rapper Notorious B.I.G. $1.1 million in their wrongful death suit against the LAPD. The case ended in a mistrial after a judge ruled that the police had concealed evidence. In other music news, 80s artifact David Lee Roth was replaced mid-morning yesterday during his New York radio show. Roth, who took over the time slot when Howard Stern abandoned terrestrial radio for the Sirius satellite network, seen his ratings drop from second down to eighth place in the New York market. All of a sudden, it's a little easier out here for a pimp. The 3-6 Mafia hit a Los Angeles recording studio yesterday with none other than Paris Hilton. The Oscar-winning rappers were recording tracks for the ubiquitous Hotel Heiress's music debut. Moving on to sports now, newest Dallas Cowboys Terrell Owens tops today's news, launching a fan club on his official site. So for $59, you get a hat, a cup, and an MP3. Not an MP3 player, mind you. No, just actually the MP3 itself. But the cap is a flex-fit hat, at least. Sweetens the pot a little. If you love NASCAR so much you could just eat it up, then you're in luck. NASCAR-branded meats are the latest license item to hit the market, offering everything from cold cuts to bacon to jumbo hot dogs. No word yet on vegetarian options, but that's probably not much of an issue. In other news, YouTube.com, in an effort to stem a rising tide of copyright violations, has placed a 10-minute cap on user uploads. NBC recently forced the site to pull down unauthorized copies of Saturday Night Live's Lazy Sunday video. And finally, Sony's UMD movie discs appear to be headed the way of the Betamax. Ouch. Despite the PSP's popularity as a gaming device, its future as a movie viewer is in question. UMD movie sales have slowed significantly since the disc's launch, and rumors are circulating that mega retailer Walmart is about to dump the format altogether. And that's today's feed. Tip your waitress.
It started with 65 teams chasing a dream, and it will end this weekend with one shining moment. The conclusion of March Madness is upon us, my friends. So we have one last NCAA tournament check-in. Now, he uses video games to provide betting advice. Ladies and gentlemen, you know him, you love him. Joining us live from Indianapolis, it's Jimmy the Geek. Jimmy, baby, looking sharp as always. How the hell are you?
Thanks, Gabby. It's like I'm a six-year-old. It's Christmas, and that looks like a shiny new puppy under the tree. I'm doing great, babe.
I'm glad to hear it, Jimmy. Look, it's been one hell of a March Madness. We're down to the final four. What do you have?
Gabby, the last time there was a sporting event this exciting and involved a lion eating a Christian, either I'm drunk on the floor or somebody has raked the bar, baby.
All right, it's probably a little bit of both there, buddy, but let's get to your picks.
You got it, babe. Cavi, this George Mason team has cost me so much freaking money, you'd think my ex-wives were out there putting up threes. Well, Jimmy says enough, damn it. It ends right now. My research shows that Billy the Kid Donovan has his gators ready to bite George Mason just above the kneecap and let him bleed out. Cinderella finally gets what's coming to her. Take Florida over the Patriots. It's my Will You Freaking Idiots Lose Already special of the week.
All right, Florida over George Mason in one semi. But what about the other side of the bracket, Jim?
All right, LSU taking on UCLA, Kevy. The Tigers, of course, caught up in the devastation brought on by Hurricane Katrina. So you got to figure God owes them one. Look for LSU and Big Baby Davis to make a nice rug out of the Bruins and stick their freaking head above the fireplace mantle. Kevin, I'm talking right next to the Yates collection and that scale model of the Sea Witch. Take the Tigers in a walk. They talk softly and carry a red stick into the final game. It's my Buy You Another Drink Gorgeous special of the week.
All right, so we have Florida and LSU in the finals. Jimmy, we still have some time, though. Do you want to take a crack at the big game, perhaps?
Kevin, does Pinocchio have wooden balls? Of course. Hell yes. We're going after the finals. Kevin, this Florida team has a little something you just can't put your finger on, but Jimmy can. It's called heart, baby, and they don't sell it at the corner, Wawa. It's one shining moment, and it belongs to the Gators. But the geek is not done, Kevy. I'm going to go and predict the final score of the game because, Kevy, that's the way I roll. Florida, 68, LSU, 64, and put all your valuables inside and then throw a big freaking lock on it, babe. It's a lock.
All
it's
right.
A lock.
Point taken. Florida winning the whole thing and a final score to boot. Jimmy, I got to say, it's been such a long tournament, and I'd imagine that you're going to take a little time off now, right?
That's a big freaking negative, Kevy. It's Girl Scout season, and I got $5,000 that says my 10-year-old sells more tag-alongs than that freaking Peterson kid, and there is money to be made. Girl Scout season, you got it.
Jimmy, you never cease to amaze me. Thank you so much, buddy. Everybody, that's Jimmy the Geek live from Indianapolis. Now, when we come back, we'll get some rock of the highest order, courtesy of musical guests, The Nervous Return, and we found a site that says they'll make anything for you, and, well, we naturally push them to the limits of good taste. It's all coming up next, so stick around, everyone. He's smiling. I got it. Hey, the internet's got something for everyone. You know, you got your holy grilled cheese sandwiches, your ironic t-shirts, and your Lego interpretations of Bible verses. And yet, for some, it's just not quite enough. So we found a site called Etsy.com, E-T-S-Y.com, where you can request specific items and people will make them for you. So, of course, we immediately found ways to really abuse this service. So we made some pretty strange requests to find out they would actually make these things.
Uh-huh.
It was a fun little experiment. The first thing we asked for was a cross-stitched Bea Arthur. Did they make it?
Well,
kinda. Okay, so what they did was they painted a pattern for us based on a picture of Bea Arthur. She's cute there. So we provided a picture, they painted the pattern, but they wouldn't do the cross-stitching because they just said it would take too long. Unbelievable.
Looks like we made some decent progress on it, though.
Yeah, we did. Thankfully, one of our producers has his own cross-stitching kit, so... Yeah, that's how we roll around these parts.
Michelle.
Yeah. Oh, you just threw him under the bus.
I'm sorry. I would be proud if I were.
Next, we asked for a scarf.
We did. Mm-hmm. Well, this wasn't just any scarf. We actually wanted George Carlin's 7 Dirty Words knitted onto the scarves. You know, the ones that the man won't let us say on television?
See that?
Did they make it?
I'm holding it right now. They did. But, of course, we had to, as you see, we had to cover some of the letters here. Let me just feed this on through here. I think you'll get the idea.
Sucker mother.
That's pretty good. So they definitely made it for us. It's great to wear in any weather.
Here's the best scarf ever.
Here's a picture of Anya, though. This is the shocking part. That's the sweet little innocent girl that made it for us. I mean, it's awesome.
I love how they let us know who was actually, who knitted that scarf.
Of course.
That dirty, dirty scarf. Finally, last but not least, we asked for an anatomically correct felt Ron Jeremy doll. Did they make it?
Yeah. Anatomically correct, my friends. So here's what we had to do. I had to draw a picture, which was slightly embarrassing during work, trying to kind of sketch with this.
We wanted them to know what we meant.
Yes, yes. So then I scanned it in, and we waited for the bits to come in. $60 later, we got pretty much what I drew. Yeah, look at that. So
now,
we, of
you
course,
know, there's certainly some restrictions.
Yeah, you can't show the twig and berries.
We've got a little bit of a plumber's crack going on in the back.
But I'm telling you, folks, it's to scale.
It's there.
It's to
there.
Scale.
All right.
In fact, and here's a picture of Carmen, who made this little perversion for us. Hope your parents are proud, Carmen. Thank you very much for your, she's $60 richer, you know, and she can add this to her resume.
Carmen can make a felt Ron Jeremy doll.
He's cute.
Correct.
A little hedgehog.
Love that. Looks like the only limit is your twisted imagination and how much you've got in your wallet when it comes to the site.
Pretty much.
Good times.
We've got detailed pictures of our uncensored handicrafts on attackoftheshow.com. And of course you can, that's great. You can head on over to Etsy.com if you want to have somebody make some crazy crap for you. Not bad, right?
Not bad at all.
Let's take some calls.
All right, Jack joins us on the phone from Long Island, New York. Hi, Jack, how are you?
Hey, what's up, guys?
Not much.
I gotta put this away. It's falling off.
You know what? Things are getting inappropriate.
We're playing with anatomically correct felt toys yourself?
Not really, but that's pretty cute.
Awesome, thanks.
Thanks, Jack. We think so. What's your question?
I just got a question about the Nintendo Revolution. Do you think that the price of the Revolution will make it a serious next-gen contender?
Mm. I mean, isn't the Revolution, aren't they already saying that it's going to be a lot lower in price than a lot of the competitors?
Yeah, traditionally all of Nintendo's hardware and software, for that matter, has been cheaper than the competition's. And yeah, you know, some early reports are saying it can be expected for around $150, maybe even $200, maybe even $100. The games might be $30 as opposed to $60, which is what, you know, some of the next-gen companies are trying for. But I think Nintendo, not only is it a wise strategy to rope gamers who have never gamed before, you know, like the older crowd, the younger kid crowd, the tweens are there already for the nostalgia factor of the older Nintendo stuff. But with the price point being where it's at, it's the perfect, like, second console. Mm-hmm. So even for the hardcore gamers that do care about the graphics and the raw horsepower, they're still going to get those guys because for an extra $100, they can have a Revolution.
It's almost not really a competitor at all. It's just a whole different thing.
Exactly. They're competing on a completely different level, and I hope it works out for them. Nintendo needs it, and I'm excited for it.
Go Nintendo. All right, next question. Peter joins us on the phone from Virginia Gardens, Florida. Hi, Peter.
Hey, Kevin Isher. How are you doing?
We're doing really good.
All right, so my question is, what's the deal with the Nintendo Go?
Now, wasn't that rumored to be the new system?
Yeah, there was like an image leaked onto the net, and it said Nintendo, and then right below it, it had the word Go, and that's when the forums blew up, and they're like, okay,
oh my god, maybe that's what they're calling it.
Exactly, or does it mean Game Online? Is that the name of their online network? Or what if that's the name of the console, because people are saying, you know, the game Go, or the name Go, rather, means five in Japan, or the word Go, so, okay, that's their fifth console, it could be that, yada yada, back and forth. The answer is nobody really knows for sure. You know, it could mean Game Online. That could be the name of their online network. If it was the name of their console, it'd be cool because you could say, hey, let's go.
Is there a significance in number five?
Play Go. It's the fifth released console by Nintendo.
Ooh, I bet that's what it is.
So, yeah, some people are saying here or there. Yeah, I certainly don't have any insider info for you, unfortunately. I do have a scarf with curse words on it. But
we also have a felt Ron Jeremy doll.
We do. Other than that, though, your guess is as good as ours, buddy. All right, now coming up after the break, no Thursday show is complete without enough rock to get you through the weekend. And thankfully, the nervous return is here to deliver, Sarah.
Yes.
Say hello.
On the next Attack of the Show, our game lab reviews every realistic grunt in Top Spin 2 for the Xbox 360 Plus. We'll meet the creator of Channel Frederator, the world's first cartoon podcast, and French graffiti artist The Invader breaches security and has his way with our set. All that on the next Attack of the Show. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to Attack of the Show, The Nervous Return! the Nervous Returns EP, The Sex, The Drugs, The Nervous Return. It's out now, and their new album due on shelves in June. Just go to attackoftheshow.com for more information. Stay where you are, though. Emails, chat, and more from The Nervous Return is coming up next.
You're watching G4, the number one podcasted network in America.
Wall-to-wall game reviews.
Always expect the unexpected.
Go to iTunes or G4TV.com for details.
iPod of the stars. Larry Wachowski's iPod. Lola, the Kinks. Walk on the Wild Side, Lou Reed. I'm Coming Out, Diana Ross. A Man and a Woman, Pierre Beru. A Boy Named Sue, Johnny Cash.
I love the voices of the iPod of the stars.
It's always changing slightly.
IRC chat room.
Yeah.
It's a little thing that goes on during the show.
Yeah.
People talk.
All right. Head Wound asks, would steroids enhance Kevin's performance on AOTS? Head Wound, you already know the answer to that question. No. He's fine the way he is. You're actually really buff.
Do you want to squeeze him again?
I do,
because
you're
under a graphic when you did it. Yeah. Uh-huh. Mm. Keep going. A little bit more.
Now tell me. Now they feel kind of...
Tell me you love me, though.
No.
Aww.
It's weird.
No, steroids are bad, kids. Stay away. Plus, if it shrank anymore, it'd be a vagina.
Oh.
Next question.
Gladius wants to know, will Kevin make an anatomically correct McPhee doll?
Oh. Yeah, not enough felt in the world, my friends. Listen, it's hard to really get it to scale when she covers up. And I've said this 1,001 times. You don't know exactly what's going on under there.
Mm.
You don't know what she's rocking. Mm-hmm. She looks hot.
Too many questions, kind of dangerous.
Exactly.
Yeah, you don't know what's going on.
But I'd love to see one.
Tronzilla, do you think commercials about smoking dope actually work? I do.
Totally.
I've bought a lot of dope from effective advertising.
I would say the moment I saw one, I was like, I gotta have some of that.
Yeah.
They're always having fun. They're always in a car. The windows are rolled up. They're giggling. Who wouldn't want some of that?
Hitting kids on bikes.
No, totally.
Wild.
It's like 10 points.
Ding. That's not funny, actually, Kevin.
No.
Smoking dope is bad,
Stay
and you
away
should
from
not
it.
Do it.
Would enhance my performance on the show, though. I'll tell you that.
Oh, it's enhanced, Ryan. Give it another try.
It enhances viewing the show.
Holy Foot Grenade asks, is this just Blair Butler's day job while she's a superhero by night? Wow, you saw right through her.
She really... apparently, she fooled him for a little while.
Yeah.
I don't know. Blair Butler's kind of a superhero.
I think she is, yeah. She's really smart.
She's a do-gooder.
Yeah.
I was told very angrily by G4 to stop following her around after hours, so I cannot confirm or deny that she's, in fact, a superhero.
Well, there's also the restraining order.
Well, exactly. They caught me changing in a phone booth near
her apartment. It wasn't just G4 saying, hey, Kevin, real nice. Please don't do that.
All right.
It was the police.
We didn't have to
forcibly
go there. Thanks,
keeping
Sarah.
You back.
Thanks. Now I feel awkward.
Unscrewed Ronin asks, which is going to be scarier, Sharon Stone showing the goods or Slither getting its goo on you? What do you think?
There's nothing good about anything Sharon Stone is showing
anymore. I'm not
sure
what's going on with her. Sharon Stone, you were a very beautiful woman back in the day.
Were.
And still are.
No, I mean,
it's not as if she has lost anything, really.
Yeah, but
it's
like,
just there is a certain age where things get a little creepy.
When she sits on the chair, you can almost hear it wheezing. It's like...
Oh.
You know, it's like
gross.
Dust fills the room. It's like, you know what? It's cool. It sounds like an old wooden door creaking closed.
How old is she? Is she actually 50? Is she over 50?
It doesn't
Does
matter.
Anyone know?
If she's over 23, it's not hot anymore.
All right, Kevin.
What?
That was a jab right at my heart, right at my aorta.
I thought you were only 22. Liar.
God.
Sinner.
Captain Smee asks, hi, Captain Smee, how are you? Wait, David Lee Roth is still alive? Yeah, but not on the air anymore, apparently.
No.
Yeah.
Correct that problem. And thus concludes another week of quality television, my friends.
Thanks to our guests, Nick Nunziata and Blair Butler. But now, one more time, The Nervous Return. Woo!
In the sheets of tragic connection.